do what? Hope in the Lord. So I pray that good, great, bad week, whatever it is, continue to hope in the Lord. Here to worship God. So we're going to sing, "Here I Am to Worship," but I really need to hear you. After you know you can trust and obey Him, after you know you can have strength and take heart, as long as you hope in the Lord, now rejoice. We are here to worship our Lord God.
Adore you, hope of a life spent with you.
Amen. Have a blessed Sabbath.
Well, I hope y'all had a good week, and Sabbath is a climax to that great week, and that you'll be spiritually blessed and strengthened at the end of the service today. As you notice, we've had our emphasis so far is on education, and we're going to continue with that emphasis today. And next Sunday afternoon, between 5 and 8, we're going to have a back-to-school bash, and I hope that you all saw that insert in your bulletin. I know some of you might not have got it if you came earlier. But plan to be here and to support the school as much as you can this year. There is something that kind of struck me this morning that I just want to share with you all just for a brief minute. As we studied our Sabbath school lesson, it talks about Peter's first sermon and conversion experience and the prejudice that was in the early church between the Jews and the Gentiles. And we focused on that a little bit this morning and wondered if there is still prejudice within the church. And we said, no, there is no prejudice in Conroe Church. Look at this congregation, multicultural. We love each other. We do anything for each other. Maybe even giving our life for each other. And I think that's wonderful. And I don't believe there's a whole lot of prejudice in this church. But come Monday morning, do we have prejudices? When we meet our co-workers on the street, and the man on the street, are there some people that we would prefer not to associate with, not to even share our faith with? And someone shared a little short story in class this morning, and I'm going to share it. They grew up non-Seventh-day Adventist, Catholic background, started dating a Seventh-day Adventist, and the friends of the Seventh-day Adventist told him that they were praying that they would break up and he wouldn't be able to date, that they wouldn't date each other anymore. Is that a form of prejudice? Should we have been praying that that person accept Christ and maybe join the church? And I just want to say, you know, prejudice quite often goes outside the walls, into the workplace, the people that we meet. And quite often we don't think about that. But I pray that we will get over that, and we will want to mingle, and we will want to share our faith with whoever it is, whenever. At this time, I'd like to invite you all to join me in prayer, and if you feel like it, just join me up front in our circle of prayer. If not, you might just kneel by your seats, but let's talk to the Lord at this time. Kind and gracious God, what an awesome privilege we have to worship an awesome God, a God that is greater and more powerful than anything, anyone that we can even imagine, a God that has promised that he will do more for us than we can imagine. And Lord, this morning we kneel here humbly, asking that you fill our lives with your presence. Help us to be so united with each other that your Holy Spirit can fall upon us as a church family, that your power can be felt in this neighborhood, that our lives will constantly reflect you wherever we are, that others will want to know more about you. Use us each day, dear Lord, as you see fit. And Lord, we know we have problems, we have difficulties. And Lord, I ask that you would forgive us for our weaknesses, forgive us for where we fall short. strengthen us. Help us to lay those shortcomings before you and reach out to you for your strength for each day. Lord, we know there are many of our church family that might have physical problems at this time, and we want to pray for them, ask that your healing hand might touch them. But above all, dear Lord, we ask that they might be able to feel your presence in that healing process. Those that are spiritually weak, those that are having problems at home, maybe with their spouses or children or in-laws, whatever it might be, dear Lord, help that your spirit can be felt in that healing process of drawing them closer together and closer to you. Lord, we ask as we look forward to starting a new school year that your presence, your Holy Spirit will be felt in this school more than it has ever been felt. I ask, dear Lord, that you'd bless each student that's going to be here, parents, the teachers. Lord, help that this institution will be a light for you, and that the mission that this church has set forth will not go in vain, but lives will be drawn closer to you. Today we ask that you would be with our speaker. Give him the right words to share with us. Help that his presence here today will be sharing you with us and will help us to have a closer walk with you. Help us to be more committed to you in every aspect of our lives. Bless our time together and help that when we leave here, we'll be strengthened and ready to face the world and be a witness for you. These things I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Happy Sabbath. I wanted to read this verse before I play the song. It's from Genesis 2, verse 7. And the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living being. So this song is called Oxygen. Take each breath as it is my first. I hold it there so deep inside me till I'm about to burst. I speak each word as it is your name. I move my lips, I see the whisper stir the gentle flame. Your heart beats and so does mine. Your love moves and I know I'm alive. You are my oxygen. I breathe you in, I breathe you out. You are my oxygen. You thank you. Thank you.
Before our principal, Mr. Cook, introduces our speaker, I just want to share just quickly a little bit about why we have invited him, and also that we as a church have and support this school and why we have it. As I have thought about different groups in our society, and I've always marveled at the Amish. Everybody know who the Amish are? Know who they are? I've always marveled that they're able to continue to exist. How is it when they are so countercultural, so different from the society around them, that they're able to keep going? And somehow they're able to pass their core values on to their children, and they continue to pass that along. And that is the one thing that I think comes to the surface as we think about the idea that Pastor Adi presented a few months back about growing young, is this. How do we pass along our values and our mission to those that are younger than we are? How do we connect and unite as a church family so that we can pass along to our young people? Why do we exist as a Seventh-day Adventist church? What is the mission that we have to give to the world? Who are we? Why do we exist? And you know, there is nothing that really solidifies it in our own hearts as when we think about what we need to show and to share and to pass along to the next generation. Because we oftentimes see in young Adventists as they leave the church and they leave the faith, and then when they have children, something clicks, right? Have you seen this before? Something clicks and they go, you know what? I want my kids to know God. I somehow want them to have the faith that I know I want, but I kind of let go of. And so they'll kind of come back to the church and sit on the edge. They'll bring their kids to Sabbath school and they kind of stay on the fringe. But folks, we want everybody to stay at the heart of our church family for their entire life. Glad I got a few amens on that. We want them to stay at the heart of our church family for their entire life. That's why we have a school. And it is so, so important. And it's so important that every single one of you be connected and involved with this school, that you know what's going on, that you can offer your time, you can offer yourselves to be able to connect in relationship with a young person. Now, we want you to do that whether there was a school or not, whether that young person is attending our school or not. We want every single one of you, whether you're 110 or whether you're just a mere kid 54. If you were here last week, you'll know what I meant. But we want you to connect with the young people that are in this congregation. That's why we have this school. That's why we're taking today to invite a special speaker to talk to us about education. And that's why at the end of his sermon, we're going to call the teachers up and have a special prayer of dedication for them. But Mr. Cook, would you please come and introduce our speaker for us today?
Thank you, Pastor. Happy Sabbath. Good morning again. Welcome. I have the privilege of introducing our speaker today. And before I do that, Pastor just really made me think about something that I heard this past week. Some of you have heard that our teachers, our staff was gone last week. We had went to the teacher conference, a national conference that was held in Chicago, Illinois. And one of the speakers, one of the keynote speakers that had finished kind of our week on Thursday there, said something that's really stuck with me that I hadn't really thought about before. He shared, he was a researcher. He was sharing how data this and data that can make our schools better, and that the research that he's done and some things he's looked to in George Barna. I don't know if you're familiar with him, but George Barna has done a lot of research on Christians in general and whether or not them and their children are actually different or their practices are different from the rest of society and the world as we know today. He's got about 30 years of experience with research, and here's what the gentleman said, and I can't remember this guy's name, but here's what he said that stuck with me. He said, if our schools die or end, cease to exist, then what research shows and what researchers are saying, like George Barna, is our faith will die and it will cease. And that really stuck with me. I've thought about that some. So, again, I got to praise this staff, and I want to praise all the people that, or I have a praise to God, and thank God for all the people that have been helping with the worker bees the past couple Sundays. Thank you all so much for that, and all of you that are dedicated to our school. We need to be united in this, and our school is a representation of our faith. And just wanted to share that with you this morning. So I don't want to keep our speaker waiting too much longer or anybody else. This is Pastor John Parchment, and he has served for the Central American Union for 41 years as a teacher, pastor, and administrator. So we're fortunate to have him here. Thank you for being here this morning. Some of the positions that he's occupied include the following. He's been a youth and educational director of the Panama Conference of Seventh-day Adventists. He's been a director and a principal of the Adventist Institute of Panama, a vice president of the Adventist University of Central America, an education and health director of the Central American Union of Seventh-day Adventists. So at this time, I would like to welcome Pastor John Parchment. And again, thank you for being here this morning.
Good morning, church. I'm really happy to be here this morning to talk about education, Christian education, Adventist style. But before, I want to invite you to, for a word of prayer, accompany me with a word of prayer. I want you to pray with your own words, your own thoughts, a moment of silent prayer. Let us ask the Lord this morning to help us to get something from the sermon that we'll be able to apply to our lives, to our church. Let us all pray, bow our heads, close our eyes, ask the Lord to help us to get something, take something from this sermon so we are able to apply it to our lives. Now let us bow our heads now for a moment of silent prayer. Amen. All right. In the book of Deuteronomy, Moses gave his final address to the children of Israel. They were camped out at the east of the Jordan, getting ready to enter the promised land. And so Moses knew that he was not going to, he was not going to go with them, but he wanted to remind them of some things that they should really remember and put into practice. They were camped there near the Jordan. And so Moses reminded them that they had a relationship with Christ, with God, and they should never forget that relationship of love that they had with God. He reminded them, oh, God had led them through the wilderness 40 years going round and round. Oh, God had kept them. He reminded them of the faithfulness of God. He reminded them that they had to trust in God. He reminded them that happiness and prosperity was guaranteed. But that depends on, that guarantee is based on two priorities he wanted them to remember. So I want you to turn your Bibles again to the book of Deuteronomy chapter 6 and let us look at the priorities, two priorities that they had to remember. Chapter 6 and verse 5. Read the following. And thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart and with all thy soul and with all thy what? And with all thy might. He reminded them that the relationship of love that they should always have with the Lord. And then the second priority is found in chapter 7. And thou shalt teach them diligently unto thy children, and shall talk of them when thou sittest in thine house, and when thou walkest by the way, and when thou liest down, and when thou risest up. Those were the priority that they should keep in mind. We teach our children through our actions, In Proverbs 22:6, we read, train up the child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. We are camped out here on earth, just like the children of Israel, but we are here on earth. We are getting ready to enter the promised land, the new Jerusalem. Am I correct? Amen. And God this morning wants us to remember that we should have a relationship of love with him. God wants us to remember this morning that we have promised to serve him, and he has also promised to be with us until the end. But God wants us to remember also that all these things that we have studied, all this responsibility that we should teach our children, because he does not want us to enter heaven by ourselves, but accompanied by whom? With our children. So we have a responsibility as teachers. We have a responsibility as church leaders. We have a responsibility as parents to take our children with us. And so this morning, I'm here to remind you of that responsibility. Love the Lord with all your heart, with all your mind, but teach our children to love the Lord also. The obedience of the obedience of the Bible mandate to teach is vital. Is vital to the survival of the church. I want to repeat that. The obedience of the biblical mandate to teach is vital for the survival of the church. In Psalms 27:3, we read, children are the heritage of the Lord. After our children, the most important person is in the school is who? The teacher. The teacher is very important. Now, let me remind you something. In the time, the Jewish nation, they had a concept to prove the importance of the teacher. Let us say, for instance, a father and the teacher was in some trouble, a problem. This was the concept was based on this. If your father and your teacher is in trouble and you have to save them, you have the opportunity to save them, they said, save the teacher first. Just to show you the idea, the importance of the teacher, save the teacher, not save your father, but save the teacher. Save the teacher first. The goal of your teacher is to help you reach your goal. Can you say that to your child? The goal of your teacher is to help you to reach your goal. You know, though, if your child is going to a public school, it's very difficult to say that. The goal of your teacher is to help you to reach your goal. Let me explain it a more simple. Your teacher goal is to get to where? To heaven. And your child goal supposed to be the same. Get to heaven. So both of them have the same goal. But when our children are in public school, that's not the goal of the teacher. That's not the primary goal of the teacher. No, I have nothing against public school. I've taught public school for 15 years also. And many of you here, maybe some of you are teachers in public school. I had a problem once. One morning, it was a Monday morning, a lot of members started to call the office. I was the director of the Department of Education. And there was a problem in the church because somebody preached the Sabbath and was condemning public schools. So a lot of people were there, what's the concept of condemning the public school? And they were talking about it. And so I was shocked that the person was preached a sermon or said something in regards against public school. Now, let me tell you the position of the church. We have nothing against public schools. We must pray for the public schools. Many of us, we learn to what? Read and write and from the public school. No. We are not against the public school, but this is the problem. We want more than what the public school can offer. The public schools prepare our children to be a good worker, a good professional, right here on earth, to earn a living. But we are looking beyond that. You get the point? We are looking towards where? Heaven. That is our primary goal. Our primary goal is not to become a doctor, a pastor, or a dentist, a teacher. No, it's to get to heaven, to serve our God, and also to serve humanity. Oh, my dear friends, we are not against. Maybe some of you, I think it was sometime in July, there was a program in regards to... they mentioned this on the news. There was a man, a teacher by the name of Mr. Robert Moore. I don't know if you heard of or you saw it. Robert Moore was a teacher in Oklahoma for 30 years. 30 years. And one day, a few of his students asked him, invited him out for lunch or something like that. He's retired now. And so he decided to go along with them. But he did not know what they had in mind. And so they took him to a park. And when they get close to the park, he noticed that there was a lot of people in the section. There were more than 300. And he began to realize that these people were students, former students of his. They surprised him, and they took him, and everybody came out, and they sang. And he was the director of a choral group, a choir. But he was an outstanding teacher. This is the public school. I'm speaking about the public school. And his students came from all over the territory, all over the United States, and from three countries. They came to honor Mr. Robert Moore because he was a very influential teacher. He was kind, he was loving, he was caring, and they wanted to express their appreciation. And that is the public school. So we don't have anything against the public school, but I want you to remember that the most important thing for us is to prepare our children to meet the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ when he comes in glory. We do not want to enter heaven alone. We want to enter heaven with whom? With our children. And that's why the Seventh-day Adventist Church invests thousands and thousands of dollars having our schools. We invest and we invest. If you are really a Seventh-day Adventist and you are really thinking of going to heaven, you must realize that we cannot go and leave our children. It don't make any sense. It don't make any sense. So that's why we invest all this money in creating our schools. And thou shalt teach them diligently unto thy children, and shalt talk to them when thou sittest in thine house, and when thou walkest by the wayside, and when thou liest down, and when thou risest up. How important is Christian education for us? Oh, my dear friend, let me tell you some of the objective of our school. The number one, prepare our children to meet Jesus Christ when he comes in glory. And we foment the Adventist culture. We have a culture, am I right? We foment our Adventist culture in our school. And I was reading, I read something not too long ago. It said, reasons why Adventist schools work. Adventist school worked because you can say to your child, the goal of your teacher is to help you reach your goal. The goal of your teacher, that is a simple saying, but it's very profound. The goal of your teacher is to help you to reach your goal. Because your teacher wants to get to heaven, and your child wants to get to heaven. So they coincide. No, you cannot say that when you go to a public school. You cannot say that because the objective is completely different. And you know one of the problems that we have? It is said that many of the great educators, they say that religion, we must leave religion to the home and leave religion to the home and also the church. Religion must be taught the home and the church. Do you believe that? the Almighty, not the school. The school for the intellectual. not the school. No, we do not believe that. When the scripture said to teach our children, lying down, walking on the, you know what I mean? That religion should be what? Religion should be intertwined in all of our children's activity. You know that there's a difference in teaching history in an Adventist school and a non-Adventist school? Do you know that? You see, in a non-Adventist school, God is completely out. There's no room for God. In an Adventist school, Adventists, they have invested thousands of dollars in creating special curriculum that when your teacher, when the teacher stands before the student, and he's given grammar, any subject, geography, Christ is in it. Christ is in it. We call it Christ-centered objective. Christ is in it. God is in it. We do not take out God. Some people believe that Christian education means that, well, before class you pray, all right? You pray before class, and you might pray after class, and that's it. But when it comes down to mathematics, no, nothing about God. And yeah, when it comes down to geography, no. You just, this is where Asia and that. No, not in Assembly Adventist School. Let me see the hands of those that attended Assembly Adventist School. Elementary or yeah. Am I speaking the truth or am I creating something different? No, in an Adventist school, the curriculum is centered around Jesus Christ, God. We never leave out God. Now, I was a principal of a school for many years in Panama, and you know that some people believe that our Adventist schools are correctional schools. You know what is correctional school? I don't know if you use the term here. Correctional school. In some of these countries, they have school like for kids that with terrible behavior. You know? And some people believe. Look, I had judges calling me. Judges. Juvenile judges calling because they want to enroll students in our school. Judges, and you know what kind of student? You know what kind of student? They said, we have heard great things about your school. We know that you are doing marvelous things. We have heard of the transformation that you have helped students to change, and we have some recommendation. No, I could never accept those students. No, not that I don't love them, but here's the thing. No, I'm speaking to you as clearly as possible. We want in our schools, and listen to this carefully, we want the Adventist influence to be very powerful. You see, we are not looking for numbers. You got it? Yeah, I want you to understand, we are not looking for number, it's quality. You got the picture. We are not looking for numbers. We have helped a lot of students. I had a student. His father was the director of the psychiatric hospital in Panama City. That was his father. His father was the chief psychiatrist at this, the psychiatry. But the psychiatrist was not able to control his son. You got it? So somebody told him that there's a school that could help him. And naturally, he went to us. No. After speaking with us and thinking, well, all right, we decided to help the gentleman. And we took the boy. No, thanks be to God. We were able to help that young man. You know what we discover? What we discover? We discovered that he had a beautiful voice. You know, in our school, we worship morning, evening, yeah, and the young man began to sing, and he had a lovely voice, and he did not realize that, and that helped him to change completely. And when we sent him back to his father, he was a complete different young man. Oh, my dear friend, today he's a professional. I received a letter 2 weeks ago, and they told me that there was a lad that attended our school, one of my students. He, right now, he's trying to be a candidate for the presidency of the country of Panama. His name is Dr. Camilo Alin. Dr. Camilo Alin. When he came to us, he came to us as a little boy in the fifth and sixth grade. But when he left that school, although he was not a Seventh-day Adventist, his parents were not Seventh-day Adventist, but he always tell everybody, I am a Seventh-day Adventist. I am a Seventh-day Adventist. And somebody slipped me a note the other day and sent me a little card and said that he's trying to be the candidate for one of the parties to become the president of the Republic of Panama. My dear friends, sometimes we don't know what we have. You know, God bless us with things, and sometimes we don't realize the blessing that we have. You know, it's like the man that sold his land. You heard of him? He sold his land to go and seek gold, and somebody bought it and found gold on the land. Somebody bought it and found gold on the land that he sold because he wanted money to go somewhere else to get gold. Oh, my dear friend, let us remember that we have a responsibility as leaders of the church. We have a responsibility as members of the church. We have a responsibility of parents to train up our children in the way they should go. And the Lord has given us the blueprint that we should follow. Let me tell you this morning what you should do. Trust and obey, for there is what? No other way to salvation but trust and obey. In the book of Ephesians, chapter 6, and verse 4, I want to read this verse to you. You know it well. Ephesians 6:4 said, "And ye fathers, provoke not your children to wrath, but bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord." Now, listen what it said. Provoke not your children to wrath. Now, you know what that means? I'm going to put it in the context of education. It means don't confuse your children. Sometimes we confuse them. We put them in a situation that they confuse. You tell them something at home. You teach them something in the church. And then they go to school and they tell them something else. Am I right? You're following me? You teach them something at home. They tell them another thing at church. Then they go to school and they hear something else. And let me tell you, school has a lot of influence. I know. I had a teacher that was a genius. And students came to sit at his feet to listen to him. The man was brilliant. never received a B in his life. Everything was A's. When he opened his mouth, beautiful. You know, you wanted to listen to him, but he was an atheist. And he influenced a lot of students. No, can you imagine? Can you imagine the danger of such a teacher? What, you hear something at home, you hear something at church, but then this brilliant teacher tells you that what you heard at church, that's not true. That is religion. That's not true. That's not true. Let me tell you the truth. Now, watch the other verse. Ephesians 4:17. Now, repeat Ephesians 4:17. Now, don't get your student confused. Then it says, "This I say therefore and testify in the Lord, that ye henceforth walk not as other Gentiles walk, in the vanity of their minds." I want you to get that phrase. In the vanity of their mind. Those teachers walk in the vanity of their mind. They are only thinking of what? They are only the intellectual. God is completely out. God is completely out. Leave God to the church. Leave God to the home. Not the school. And so the Bible warns us, our children get confused when we have them, place them in such a situation. We call that there's mental dualism. You know that mental dualism, which means that, oh no, what the church says, that's fiction. No. The real thing is what you get in school. The real thing is what you are taught in the books of science. That's the real thing. Oh, my dear friends, we must get away from that. And let me invite you and tell you that the reason why we spend so much money to create our schools and to help our schools to function. As members of this church and as a congregation looking forward to the coming of Jesus Christ, let us invest our time. Let us invest our money to give our children the best. To give our children the best. We may not have the best edifice. We might not have the best laboratories. But let me tell you, the best teacher has the influence, an influence over the teachers in our school, and that is Jesus Christ. We may not have not the best edifice, but what is taught in our schools is more than good. What is taught in our school, that will take your child to heaven. That will give him a strong foundation and build his character. And that's the thing that you're going to take to heaven. What you want to take to heaven? Your money? No. The big house that you have? No. The nice car? No. The character. Oh, my dear friends, support our local church schools. Through the power of God, we can serve our children by supporting our school, and we can help them to build their character. Now, there are three things I want you to remember in building their character. Before I take my seat, there are three things. A Christian education of Adventist orientation will help our children to develop a Christian character, so they face So as they face the different problems of life, they will go through and they will go through life facing these problems and processing them by the following way, through three concepts: the concept of evaluation, determination, and elimination. The concept of evaluation, determination, and elimination. Three things. Now, for them to function, let me give you an idea. When I was a young boy, one day I was walking, and there's a man that lived in the community. He had a furniture store, and so he would build, you know, he had people working for him, making furniture, and it was the time to pay them. So he goes around on a bicycle, and I was walking, and he was in front of me. The place was lonely, a lonely road. And I saw that he dropped something dropped from his pocket or somewhere from the bicycle. And so I ran and I picked it up. And when I opened it, it was filled with money, bills, dollar bills. When I tell you, I've never seen so many bills in a big bag. And so I started to think right away. No, you understand what is going through my mind. Wow, the thing that I could buy. You know, I started thinking the thing that I could buy, what I could do, who I could help. So the evaluation, I'm evaluating the situation. But remember, I was taught in school Christian values. I was taught at home Christian values and in church. And so that begins now. There's a conflict in my mind. But this, it's going fast, evaluation. So I am determined to do what now? My determination going to base upon the teaching that I have received. And thanks be to God. No. What prevailed right away? I remember the teaching of my teacher, summer school teacher. I remember my fifth grade teacher at school. I remember my mother. And immediately I went through the process of elimination. I eliminated the concept of taking the bag. And so I ran behind the man. And I said, Mr. Markland. And when I raised the bag and he saw the bag, he turned around right away and came and he took his bag. And he thanked me naturally. It was filled with bills that he had to pay the people that were working for him. Oh, the man thanked me. He took me to a little refresqueria, a place that sell like soda and things like that, and he bought me some cake and things like that. I don't know where, and I think that was great. And naturally, when I told my mother about it, she was proud of me. But you see, the process, there was no conflict. What I learned at home, what I learned at school, and what I learned at church, everything come together. You see, no conflict. No conflict. Everything come together. There was no confusion in my mind. So I went through elimination, evaluation, determination, and elimination. Oh, my dear friends, it is so important that our children be placed in the right environment. Place them in the right environment. Thank be to God that you have a school. You know, there are many churches would like to have a school, but they don't. Many churches, and all difficult. When I came here to Houston, I did not, in Central America or in Panama, there are schools, we have schools all over the place. When I came here, it was so difficult to send a child to school because you live all the way, You understand what I'm saying. You know the distance. And if you live in this, and you live in this area, and you live in an area that you can really make it and send your child, I will admonish you. I will admonish you to do that. And remember, Seventh-day Adventist schools are great institutions. Great institution. I'm going to tell you that they will help your student, help your child to grow strong in the faith. They'll help. And what you are teaching them with at home, they will hear also at school. What you are teaching them at church, they will hear also in school. And that will help them to prepare much better to receive Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior when he shall return to this earth with all his glory. May the Lord bless us and help us to continue to serve our schools, to help our children. And maybe you don't have a child, but you could help somebody. Maybe you don't have a child now. Maybe you don't have a daughter or a son, but maybe you could contribute to help some child to receive a Christian education. May the Lord continue to bless us and keep us, and may we all continue to work for this salvation of our children.
Would you just join me with a hearty amen to say thank you? Amen. Thank you so much, Pastor Parchment. And now I would like to invite our teachers up here, please. Our teachers, would you come join me up here? And if you are a teacher anywhere, I want you to come join us up here. Don't care where you teach. I want you to come and join us up here. But we want to have a special prayer. And Pastor Parchment, would you come down here and join me? And I want Pastor Adi, if you would come join me as well up here. But we are so grateful for you coming and sharing that with us. But you know, it is so true, but I gotta say, I haven't thought about that in the way as you presented it, but it is so very true that when you are teaching one thing at home and you're teaching another thing in school, or you're teaching one thing in the home and in the church, and you're teaching another thing in the school, you create all kinds of confusion for your child. And we know that what wins out if just naturally allowed to flow. Let me give you an example. If you have a bag full of all good apples and one rotten apple, do all the good apples make that rotten apple turn good? What happens? The rest of those apples become rotten because of that rotten apple. And so don't carry that too far, but you understand my illustration, right? You understand my illustration that if in the home we're teaching one thing, in the church we're teaching one thing, and then in the school it's something different, it's contradictory, it's going to cause a lot of confusion for our children. Well, as you see our teachers here, thank you so much, guys, for committing your lives to this. It is a ministry. It is a ministry and it is a calling. And I will also tell you, and I'm going to let you folks know as well, which you probably have seen, that in the years that I have lived within this church, which is all of them, because I was born into an Adventist family and a pastor's family, I will tell you that the devil makes as a priority, number one, to go after, to create problems, to create conflict, and to create chaos. He goes after our schools. He goes after our schools. And he targets them. And oftentimes, he is successful. But you know what? That's okay. If we hang in there, and we allow the Lord to continue to do his thing, the Lord will be victorious. And if you were here last week, we talked a lot about victory. And folks, there's no doubt in my mind that the Lord will make us victorious if we want him to and will allow him to. So, enough said. This is what happens when you give a preacher a mic. Teachers, we love you. And we are so thankful for you here in our school. And I want to invite every single one of you to stand. If you want to stand in support and say, we stand in support of our school, our teachers, and our children. And that we want to pass along to our children and to the next generation the things that God has blessed us with. The things that God has given us. We want to pass along to the next generation. Thank you for standing. Pastor Parchment, would you say a special prayer of dedication for all of these folks? And we're going to, you know what we're going to do? We're going to join hands up here. So if you would just join hands with me. And as Pastor Parchment says prayer for us.
Let us pray. Oh, Father and our God, we are most grateful to you this morning that we have an opportunity to have a school here in Conroe. Oh God, thank you for that opportunity. Thank you also for the brethren in this church that have that vision, that have the desire to make this school successful. We know, dear Lord, that it's very difficult. There are problems, financial problems. But we know that you have the solution to all of these problems.
Amen.
We ask you to strengthen our faith, dear Lord, because it's a great battle. Strengthen our faith that we will look at in this church and we will find each boy, each girl. We will take a census and we will do everything in our power to make sure that child, whether he has it or not, be able to receive a Christian education.
Amen.
In our school. Father, open the way for us. And Lord, look down upon your servant, the teacher, this morning. They have a difficult task, dear Lord. Help them that they may continue to consecrate their lives to thee. Help them that they can shine, dear Father, that they can become true examples, that they can lead not only by words, but by deeds and by actions. Oh God, bless the school board. Help them to come up with creative ideas that would help the school to continue to progress. Bless the pastor, dear Lord, that he may continue to inspire to and to guide them through the way. God, we know that this is not an easy task, but you never tell us that the way will be easy. But you have promised us that you will help us to solve the problems. And so we place them into your hands. And we ask this, Father, that this school here may the best school here that this institution has ever experienced. Oh Lord, may your spirit be with every student. May your spirit will be with every teacher. And God, help us to hold hands as a family. Help us to love each other. Help us, dear Father, to realize that we are in this together, and together we will stand no matter what happened, because we know that you are on our side.
Amen.
Thank you again, God, for what you have done for us as individuals, what you have done for us as a family, what you have done and you're going to do for us as a church. We ask all these mercies in Jesus' name. Amen.
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 As we get ready to sing the closing hymn, there's two people, actually, that I was thinking of, and I wanted to mention here before that. One is, we have just hired a math tutor. Please share with me her name.
Kristen Gardner.
Kristen Gardner. She is a member of the Northwest Church currently, but she is going to come and be a math tutor with us, just a wonderful young lady who is going to be with us. And then also, I also had a request for a teacher that was formerly with us, Mabel. And just they are included in our prayer and our dedication here. Thank you. You may have a seat now. But yes, thank you so very much as we get here. I'll give this to you, Mr. Cook.
Just want to say thank you. We teachers and staff that have been visiting all these other churches, we have given this plant to each church we visited. So we're going to give this to our Conroe church today and say thank you for the dedication and for this time and for all your support. Just a small token of appreciation. We appreciate you all. Thanks. Okay.
All right, church family, again, let's stand for hymn 185, Jesus is all the world to me.
Father, thank you so very much for this challenge. Lord, be with us. Help us to re-experience a walk with you. Help us to re-experience the life and the love that we have with you. And then, Lord, help us and give us the strength and the ability and the know-how to pass this along to the next generation. Lord, we can't do it without the power of the Holy Spirit, so we are pleading for the Holy Spirit. And Lord, forgive us for where we fall short. Lord, we make a lot of mistakes. We mess it up frequently. But Lord, we know that you are a merciful, loving, and gracious God. So send your blessing in a powerful way, and we pray this because of Jesus. Amen.